Welcome to the newest installment of Literary Criticism in the Classroom, brought to you by the David and Alex Film Troupe.
Oh, hello! I'm your host, Dr. Haggard Schwartz. You may remember me from my recent work dealing with archetypal/myth criticism.
Quoth the Raven, nevermore. This line, among many others, would frame the life of a man shrouded in mystery, whose fame would not find him until years after his death. Edgar Allan Poe was a dark enigma by all means, and many considered him to be a part of the American Romantic movement. Best known for his dark and somber tales, Mr. Poe was not a stranger to mystery. Many details of his life are still unknown today, even the exact circumstances of his death. He was one of the first Americans to write short stories, and many credit him with the creation of the detective fiction genre. Also unique to Poe was the fact that he was the first well-known American writer who attempted to make a living based solely off his works, leading to a fiscally troublesome life and career. This film will take you on a journey through the dark and gritty details of Poe's life! You will see a young man torn apart by debt, alcohol, and a love life plagued by misery and death. We assure you, this movie is 100% credible, and we hope that you will ascertain a certain level of understanding of this great man and his great works. Along with this understanding, we hope you see the world as Poe saw it. Or in his words, all that we see or seem is but a dream within a dream.
The protagonist of his own life, Edgar Allan Poe, was born to David and Elizabeth Arnold Hopkins Poe. Poe was born in 1809 in the beautiful small village of Boston, Massachusetts. Little Edgar never knew his father, as David abandoned his family a short year after Edgar was born.
Wait!
Look, honey bunny buttercup! I never wanted a kid named Edgar anyway! I'm no longer physically attracted to you.
Oh, Muffin Boo Boo Bear! How's an early 19th century woman supposed to take care of little Edgar, his older brother William Henry, and his half-sister Rosie all by herself? I mean, the suffrage movement isn't for another 120 years. And I'm still wearing hoop skirts and bustles, for goodness sake! I feel dejected, yet strangely hopeful.
But that hope would not last for long. A year after Edgar's father left the family, Elizabeth developed tuberculosis and died. Suddenly.
I'm merely 2 years old, now left alone in this cold, dark world. Maybe I'll turn to poetry to help me cope with such traumatic losses I've suffered so early in my little life.
In Richmond, Virginia, Frances Allan convinced her wealthy merchant husband, John, to take the orphan child, Edgar, into their home. It was here that Edgar was to be raised, his early influences being tales told by the skippers and sea merchants. During his stay in Richmond, Edgar Allan Poe matured rapidly and awkwardly. During his days of youth in Richmond, Edgar enjoyed listening to the tales of seamen. It can be assumed that these dark tales heard by Poe deeply influenced his future dark writings.
There I was, down in the water about 50 leagues under the sea, searching for this here buried treasure. Now out of the deep comes the reverse mermaid. Now there, sunny boy, Jim boy, sunny boy, I don't know if you've ever seen a reverse mermaid. It's not as beautiful, but it's far more practical. Now she took me back to her mer lair, and things started getting fishy. Then, just as she was about to walk the plank, her merfather burst in.
Wait, was it a reverse merfather or a regular merfather?
This is my story, Sonny Boy, Jim Boy Boy. It was a normal merfather.
Oh, okay.
He barged in with his trident and stabbed me in my eye. So now I wear this scar as a reminder of the deep, dark tale. And I took my sword and I cut off his hand. And now I carry it with me everywhere for the one day that Mer King comes back and trades it for his daughter, who I love.
Edgar's childhood was rife with experiences such as the Skipper's tales and experiences with the dead and dying. Edgar was greatly drawn to death, as demonstrated by the anecdote that a young Edgar was once seized with terror when he passed a graveyard, convinced that the spirits of the dead would grasp him and drag him into the depths of the dead.
From childhood's hour I have not been, as others were I have not seen, as others saw I could not bring, my passions from a common spring. From the same source I have not taken, my sorrow I could not awaken, my heart to joy at the same tone, and all I loved alone. Then, in my childhood, in the dawn of a most stormy life, was drawn, from every depth of good and ill, the mystery which binds me still.
After growing up in Virginia, Edgar moved to Scotland and England in 1815 for 5 years, where he attended a public education institution. His days as a schoolboy were most likely plagued by bullying and exile. Knowing life on the British Isles wasn't for Edgar, the Allans decided to move back to Richmond, Virginia.
Why, hello, John Allan, my foster father. What do you want?
We're gonna move back to Richmond. Are you still making them words rhyme again? I thought I told you to stop that!
Edgar's life would be continuously plagued by the tumultuous relationship he had with his foster father.
My mean old dad. He's making me mad. Maybe I'll write something down to reverse my frown.
Realizing his gift for the first time, a legend is born.
In visions of the dark night, I have dreamed of joy departed, but a waking dream of life and light,
yes,
hath left me broken-hearted. Ah, what is not a dream by day to him whose eyes are cast on things around him with ray, turned back upon the past? That holy dream, where all the world was chiding, hath cheered me as a lovely beam, a lonely spirit guiding. What though that light through storm and night so trembled from afar? What could there be a purely light in truth's day star?
Once back in Richmond, Edgar began writing poetry in his early teens. It was here that he would meet his first true love.
For her this rhyme is penned, whose luminous eyes, brightly expressive as the twins of Leda, shall find her own sweet name, that nestling lies upon the page and rapt from every reader. Search narrowly the lines, they hold a treasure, divine, a talisman, an amulet, that must be worn at heart, search well the measure. The words, the syllables do not forget, the trivialest point, or you may lose your labor, and yet there is in this no Gordian knot, which one might not undo without a sabre, if one could merely comprehend the plot.